This is the beginning of Zoo Time. All I need to tell you is that the person speaking is called Guy Abelman. That tells you something. You need to know, for what happens, that he once wrote a novel called Who Gives a Monkey? Who Gives a Monkeys? That's an English expression which you probably all know because you speak such good English, but it means who cares about something. You also need to know that he's in love with his wife's mother. And you also know that this character is not me. When the police apprehended me, I was still carrying the book I'd stolen from the Oxfam bookshop in Chipping Norton, a pretty Cotswold town where I'd been addressing a reading group. I'd received a hostile reception from the dozen or so of the members, who I realised too late had invited me only in order to be insulting. It's a bit like being here, actually. Why do you hate women so much? One of them had wanted to know. Oh, could you give me an example of my hatred of women? I inquired politely. She most certainly could. She had hundreds of passages marked with small, sticky, phosphorescent arrows, all pointing accusingly at the pronoun he. What's wrong with he stroke she? She challenged me, making the sign of the oblique with her finger only inches from my face, wounding me with punctuation. Well, he is neuter, I told her, stepping back. It signifies no preference for either gender. Neither does they. No, but they is plural. So why are you against plurality? And children, another had wanted to know. Why do you detest children? I explained that I didn't write about children. Precisely, was her jubilant reply. The only character I identified with in your book, a third reader told me, was the one who died. Only she didn't say book. Almost no one any longer said book to rhyme with took or look, or even fuck as in fuck you, you bastard, which was the way it was pronounced in flat-voweled, lawless Lancashire, just a few miles to the north of the sedate, sleepy peat bogs of Cheshire, where I grew up. Burke was how she said it. The only character I identified with in your Burke, as though a double O was a hyperbole too far for her. I'm gratified, I said, that you found her death moving. She was quivering with that rage you encounter only among readers. Was it because reading as a civilized activity was over that the last people doing it were reduced to such fury with every page they turned? Was this the final paroxysm before expiry? Moved? I feared she might strike me with my Burke. Who said I was moved? I was envious. I identified with her because I'd been wishing I was dead from the first word. Were dead, I said, putting on my jacket. I'd been wishing I were dead. I thanked them for having me, went back to my hotel, polished off a couple of bottles of wine I'd had the foresight to buy earlier, and fell asleep in my clothes. I'd agreed to go to Chipping Norton for the opportunity it offered me to visit my mother-in-law, with whom I had for a long time been thinking of having an affair. But the stratagem had been foiled by my wife uncannily choosing that very time to have her mother visit us in London. I could have caught the train back and joined them for dinner, but decided to have a day to myself in the country. It wasn't only the women at the reading group who wished they was dead. Getting up too late for breakfast, I took a stroll through the town. Nice, Cotswold stone, smell of cows. Why are there no natural descriptions in your novel? I'd been unfairly interrogated the day before. Needing sustenance, I bought a Herbie sausage roll from an organic bakery and wandered into the Oxfam bookshop, eating it. A chalk white assistant with discs in his earlobes, like a Zambezi bushman, pointed to a sign saying, no food allowed on the premises. A tact thing, presumably. You don't fill your face when the rest of the world is starving. From his demeanour, I assumed he knew I was a hater of Zambezi Bushmen, as well as women and children. I put what was left of the sausage roll in my pocket. He was not satisfied with that. A sausage roll in my pocket was still, strictly speaking, food on the premises. I stuffed it slowly into my mouth. We stood eyeing each other up, white Zambezi bushmen and Cheshire-born, London-based, misogynistic, paedophobic writer of Burke's books, box, anything but books, waiting for the sausage roll to go down. Anyone watching would have taken the scene to be charged with post-colonial implications. After one last swallow, I asked if it was all right now for me to check out the literary fiction section. Literary. I burdened the word with heavy irony. He turned his back on me and walked to the other end of the shop. What I did then, as I explained to the constables who collared me on New Street, just a stone's throw from the Oxford bookshop, I had to do. As for calling it stealing, I didn't think the word was accurate, given that I was the author of the book I was supposed to have stolen. So what word would you use, sir? The younger of the two policemen asked me. I wanted to say that this already more closely approximated to a critical discussion than anything that had taken place in the reading room, but settled for answering his question directly. I had enough enemies already in Chipping Norton. Release, I said. I would say that I have released my book. Released it from what, exactly, sir? This time it was the older of the two policemen who addressed me. He had one of those granite bellies you see on riot police or Louisiana sheriffs. I wondered why they needed riot police or a Louisiana sheriff in Chipping Norton. Roughly what I said to him was this. Look, I bear Oxfam no grudge. I would have done the same in the highly unlikely event of my finding a book of mine for sale secondhand in Morrison's. It's a principal thing. It makes no appreciable difference to my income where I turn up, torn and dog-eared. But there has to be a solidarity of the fallen. The book, as prestigious object and source of wisdom, every man I will go with thee and be thy guide and all that, is dying. Resuscitation is probably futile, but the last rites can at least be given with dignity. It matters where and with whom we end our days. Officer. Before they decided it was safe, or at least less tedious, to return me to society, they flicked, I thought sardonically, but then beggars can't be choosers, through the pages of my book. It's a strange experience having your work speed-read by the police in the middle of a bustling Cotswold town, shoppers and ice-cream-licking tourists stopping to see what crime could have been committed. I hoped that something would catch one of the cop's eyes and make him laugh, or better still, cry. But it was the title that interested them most. Who gives a monkeys? The young officer had never heard the expression before. It's short for who gives a monkey's fuck, I told him. I had lost much and was losing more with every hour, but at least I hadn't lost the northerner's full-blooded pronunciation of the ruderies, even if Cheshire wasn't quite Lancashire. Now then, he said. But he had a question for me since I said I was a writer. Since I said I was a writer. He made it sound like a claim he would look into when he got back to the station. And as I obviously knew something about monkeys, how likely did I think it was that a monkey with enough time and a good computer could eventually write Hamlet? I paused. I think you can't make a work of art without the intentionality to do so, I told him, no matter how much time or how many computers you've got. He scratched his face. Is that a yes or a no? Well, in the end, I said, I guess it depends on the monkey. Find one with the moral courage, intelligence, imagination, and ear of Shakespeare, and who knows? But then if there were such a monkey, why would he want to write something that's already been written? I didn't add that for me, the more interesting question was whether enough monkeys with enough time could eventually read Hamlet. But then I was an embittered writer who had just taken a battering. The Louisiana sheriff, meanwhile, was turning the evidence over in his hands as though he were a rare book dealer considering an offer. He opened Who Gives a Monkey at the dedication page. To the fairest of the fair, my beloved wife and mother-in-law. That's coming in a bit rich, isn't it, he said. What is? Saying that you love your mother-in-law. I peered over his shoulder at my dedication. It was a few years since I'd come up with it. You forget your dedications. Given enough time, you even forget your dedicatees. No, I said, no, look, it's my wife who's the beloved, to my beloved wife and to my mother-in-law. The adjective applies only to the first of them. Shouldn't you put the comma before the and in that case? He jabbed the page with his finger, showing me where he thought the comma ought to have gone. Oxford, I remember, had its own rules for where commas go. The Oxford comma had long been a matter of fractious controversy inside the university, but I hadn't thought the constabulary was hot on the subject as well. No doubt Oxford also had its own rules regarding the doubling of epithets. Wasn't there a word for the rhetorical device I'd inadvertently, assuming it had been inadvertence, deployed? Something like zeugma, only not zeugma. Maybe the policeman knew. Listen, I said, as you appear to be an unusually discerning reader, can I make you a present of this book? You certainly cannot, he told me. Not only would I be guilty of taking a bribe if I accepted it, I'd also be guilty of receiving stolen property. In the circumstances, I considered myself lucky to have got off with a caution. Those were no small transgressions, stealing a book, leaving out a comma, and scheming to misappropriate my wife's mother. Can I just say, without wanting to be fawning and flattering like Osric in Hamlet, that I love reading in this country. Why do you get jokes so much quicker and so much and with so much more full-blooded appreciation than the English do? I just leave you to just. But you do. It's lovely to read in this country. If someone were ever to say to me, come and live here and just read to us every night, just in case there's anybody here that can make this offer, I will consider it very seriously.
You said before you started reading, Howard, you said something quite close to what your protagonist and narrator says. And I can't resist the temptation, therefore, to put the riposte that he immediately gets from Vanessa, his wife. And she says to him, just a few chapters later, because you said, almost as if it were an afterthought before you started reading, oh, and it's not me, by the way, something like that. And there's a conversation in chapter 5 of the novel where... he's talking to her about his job of being a novelist, and he says, I'm always somebody other. Being somebody other is my work. And she says, no, it isn't. You're always you. You just give yourself different names. And you've kind of tempted any reader, especially one like me, as I said before, we started steeped in your oeuvre. You tempt us to think about that because you've written a novel about a novelist and he is quite a... He is a novelist who's given this wonderful sort of splenetic voice, which is very tempting to want to give to you.
It's tempting, yes. I have tempted you.
Yes.
But you don't succumb to every temptation,
no.
Do you?
No, but hearing you read it aloud... as I'm sure everybody here heard and enjoyed, the voice of the novelist actually becomes your voice, and you must know that readers, including good readers, not foolish readers, are going to want to make that association.
Yes, but they quite simply shouldn't. They are, and they do, and they do all the time, and that's why I'm having some fun with it in the book. That's why it's dramatised. If Shakespeare were here tonight, and we're reading out, and we're reading from Hamlet, you would say, you read that, that you seem so at home in that, that sounds so like your voice, you must be Hamlet. And he would say to you something almost identical to what I've said.
Well, it's slightly different, isn't it? Because the novel, I mean, not all your novels, of course, are in the first person, but this one is. So that, in a sense, everything is Guy Abelman, isn't it? Even the bits of conversation he chooses to report from others, the policeman, his wife, whoever it is, are ones selected by him. So he is the impresario of the story.
Of course he is, and that is always the case in a first-person novel. But, you know, part of the fun of writing a first-person novel. And here Dickens is a good person to learn from. All that we know about Pip that Pip doesn't tell us in Great Expectations, the sense that we get of the world outside Pip, simply from listening to Pip, although it's his voice, this is the joy of writing, the challenge of a first person. There are many writers here that will all recognise this. The joy of how do you get a world outside the person? How do you get a purchase on that which is not the person, even while that person is doing all the telling? But it's doable, and it happens, and you can do it. And the mistake is to suppose that, you know, that that person is in control of everything, or that that person is... The real thing is if you do a very good job of it, and you make that first person's voice very, very, very vivid, and you feel you hear him and you know him, then people do think it must be you. And forget that the artistry, I mean, allowing that there is artistry, the artistry is going into precisely that subterfuge.
But it is it's not just a temptation. I mean, it's a different kind of thing when you write a novel I love of yours, Kaluki Knights, the narrator is a cartoonist. Okay, well, that's not a million miles away from what you do, but it's much further away than is the career of a novelist. This is your career. So you started off with those imagined book group in Chipping Norton, poor Chipping Norton. And it's the natural thing for us hearing that is to think, well, Howard must have heard things like that. He must have or read things like that said about him, or you must have done.
I have.
Yes.
I have.
So there is a transposition of experience.
Well, of course there is. There is a transposition of experience. Of course there is. And I was very... I don't approve, really, of books about writing. I don't like them. I always don't like... There are some I can think of that are marvellous. But I don't like reading them, and I've never wanted to write them. And I thought very hard before doing a novel about a novelist. And I thought the only justification for this is that it's wild. Is that it's wild, that it's, you know, it's extreme on every page, and this novel is extreme on every page. And if a reader doesn't have a taste for extremity and hyperbole, it's not the book.
Would it be mischievous of me to suggest that actually this is a novel you are sort of in, perhaps liberated to write, a novel about a failed novelist who has no readers anymore and who thinks that probably hardly any decent novelist has any readers anymore and the whole thing's going down the pan. Would you be liberated to write that by winning the Booker Prize? Do you think that freed you to do it?
Well, here's an interesting thing. The novel was half written before I won the Booker Prize.
Ah. But, I mean, it does...
And you may say, but that then gave me the liberation to go on.
Yes.
Or not to tear it up. But the impulse to write the novel, predates winning the Booker Prize, a book I didn't expect to win, and certainly didn't expect to win it with that book.
But I mean, it is a.
But there is no novelist now writing. I would have thought that they might not want to write this particular book. But and I hope they don't, because I want this to be my terrain. But there's been nobody that won't know many of these feelings.
Yeah.
That coming to the reading group experience. There's no novelist that hasn't had the reading group experience. Where are you all? You know it, you go to a reading group and they are, you can't work out, why are they so rude to you?
But
I've only written a book. They're so rude to you. They're staggeringly rude to you. I mean, much ruder even than this. I mean, I don't think I can bear to write. how rude they are. And then you get caught up in this nonsense about... I always stop halfway through. I always go and I say, I'm not going to say anything if you invite me along to a reading group and you're talking about one of my books. It will be instructive for me to sit here quietly and hear you talking. I would enjoy it. I won't interfere. That's not my play. How lovely of you to have asked me, because I'm polite. I thank them. And then about half an hour in, I can't sit there. I can't. I just have to say, I'm very, very sorry. I won't keep you for a moment. And then I give them an hour lecture on how you read. Because someone's got to give them an hour. Someone's got to do it. I happen to be there, so I have to do it. And I have to say, the fact that you don't like any of the characters is entirely irrelevant. The fact that you don't identify with any of the characters is entirely irrelevant. The fact that you find the book boring might be a statement about you. What if this book is boring because you're boring? What if you're too stupid to understand this book? What if you're so stupid you should actually never be allowed to read a book? Then I thank them very much. I finish the wine. I put on my go home and vow I'll never go to a reading group again until I'm suckered in the next. Every writer in this room knows that experience.
I make a confession here, just as if it's just you and me, Howard, and you know the whiskey's been open. There's nobody else here. I confess that. Your description just now, but also in the novel, makes me think. The rudeness is, it must be a kind of compliment, because I've spoken to such a group in Chipping Norton in the last 9 months, and they were charming. They were lovely to me. They were absolutely lovely.
They've read this. They know how to behave now. That's the... I clean them up for you. This is the power of literature.
Yeah. We would have to check up that you were there first, wouldn't we? I think probably...
I have never been to Chipping Norton.
Oh, you've never been there?
It's a novel. It's made up. Where is Chipping Norton?
Chipping Norton. It's where you say it is. It's in the Cotswolds. I think probably the difference was I was talking about somebody else's book, not my own. I was talking about Jane Austen's books.
Ah, well.
So well. It's kind
all
of
identify with Jane Austen.
I think that's unfair to them. But anyway, Chipping Norton can vindicate.
So they should. I adore Jane. I love Jane Austen's work. I don't mean to be rude about Jane Austen when I say that. But there is a way of reading Jane Austen which is a touch supine.
Okay. Well, we won't go off there. Let me ask you then about another a sort of aspect of Guy's kind of animating despair, if that's not too much of a contradiction, which you've already sort of mentioned, which is his feeling about the book, the Burke, what's happening to the Burke. I'll read a little bit, if I may, which is a list, and there are, you know, you're a lover of, like all good novelists, you're a lover of lists in their right place. And here is the list. And I wonder to what extent, I wonder what you think about this list. I know he's an invented character, but here's the list. And it goes with the book group. Nor did I think I was wholly to blame for the crisis in publishing. The devaluation of the book as object, the disappearance of the word as the book's medium, library closures, Oxfam, particular, I think the Oxfam's a bee in the bonnet, but anyway, Oxfam, Amazon, ebooks, iPads, Oprah, apps, Richard and Judy, Facebook, Formspring, I don't know, is that an inventor? I don't know what Formspring is.
No, it exists.
Formspring, Yelp, 3 for 2. I saw a book of mine, 3 for 2 in Waterstones, my heart leapt. I thought, finally, the big time. 3 for 2, the graphic novel, Kindle, Vampirism.
It's a good list, isn't it?
It's a good list. A good list.
But that's all you can say. It's a good list.
Yes.
It's a fun, and it's so much fun. I mean, to write, there's got to be some fun in this.
Yes.
For the writer as well as the reader, and making a list, you know, and it starts with Rabelais, isn't it? Rabelais, the great maker of lists. Once you've read those lists,
yes,
in Rabelais, when you're a schoolboy and you get your Rabelais from the library because it's a dirty book, and you see those lists and you think, isn't that just wonderful? One day I will grow up and be a writer and I will be able to make lists.
Yes.
But of course, this is what I wanted to do in this book was to make it one and the same. I wanted to make it preposterous, but also at the very edges of extremity, true. There are things there that we should worry about. 3 for 2, I've been pleased to be part of 3 for 2. I'm sorry it wasn't 3 of mine. But of course there are things there, and of course there's an absurdity in it all. Yes. And Guy is an absurd person, and you're quite right to cite his wife, who punctures him.
Constantly.
I was thinking of D.H. Lawrence here, because I've been a great admirer of Women in Love, and people get... I love Women in Love, and people often complain about the main character of Women in Love, who is Birkin, who sounds very, very much like Lawrence, yes, and says things that Lawrence says elsewhere in essays. But nonetheless, this is a novel, and at the moment you're reading Women in Love, it's not Lawrence, it's Birkin. And there are some... And one of the ways that Lawrence deals with himself, as it were, or with the possibility that this could be him, is to give Ursula some wonderful dismissive lines of him. And I wanted to make Vanessa a kind of Ursula to Guy Abelman's Birkin.
But then it's a very good parallel. You're aware, or lots of people who like, I love Lawrence. But one of the things that I think I became aware of over time reading Lawrence's fiction is that sense of his presence, which you don't get with all great novelists at all, but that sense of his possible presence there is part of the deal. That's part of what it's about. Yeah. And of course, he's a great writer, so it's undercut and shifted around, and he probably, in his fiction, he can unsettle himself in a way that he wasn't perhaps prepared to, you know, outside his fiction. But he's a particular kind of writer because of that. You know, when you read a Saul Bellow novel, it surely is part of one's reading of it, one's experience of it, to know that this is stuff about him, these are things that happened, and he put them in there. And of course, it's turned into a novel, but you know that the alchemy is part of what you can appreciate. And that's different, isn't it? I mean, and you're different from novelists who really... You know, you have to have some kind of absurd psychoanalytical argument to try and find the novelist in the novel.
Yes, but not... I mean, as far as worrying about the state of the novel, worrying about the state of the word, worrying about the state of literary civilization is concerned, then I've got no objection to anybody saying, well, you do sound very much like Guy Abelman at times, and I can find you articles you've written, yes, Howard, that Guy Abelman could have written. Yeah. Yeah, there is. You are meant to feel that there is slippage every now and then, and that the person writing this book, that's not me, but I know what he means at this moment. And I might so know what he means that at some moment I will really take possession of him and help him along. And help him along with the rhetoric of his anger. Yeah.
So do you think? I mean, is that do you find that a kind of a challenge or even an obstacle? The fact that, unlike the other novelists from the past that we've mentioned, I read your newspaper columns. I know what your voice sounds like in your newspaper columns, and there are lots of readers. Most probably of the people who love your novels will read you in the press. Do you think I must sort of try to establish a distance?
No, because the me of the newspaper novels isn't me.
Yes.
It's never me. If you're writing, I mean, every instinct in me, one never knows how good a writer one is, but one knows what kind of writer. I'm a writer of fiction. I make things up, and that doesn't mean that some of the things that I make up haven't almost happened or even happened. But even if they've happened, I'm still making them up. At the moment that you're writing, it's not you. The moment that you're writing, the fact that you're putting words together, leave characters out, the fact that you're putting words together, those words are building up to something that's not what you believe. You falsify what you believe. I don't really have belief. People read my columns and they think they know what I believe. They're wrong. I don't have belief. I have some angers, but I don't have some beliefs. I very much hold by... I brought some notes, and I'll probably come onto this when I get a chance to talk about in a workshop or something about Shakespeare. I very much hold to what writers like D.H. Lawrence and Milan Kundera is very good on this, both have said... No writer should have an opinion. In the what you do outside your writing is neither here nor there. But in the act of writing, you do not have an opinion. That's not what you're doing. You're not expressing what you believe. Novelists don't, if they're any good, don't express what they believe. You don't believe anything when you're a writer. This is the justification for art, not just fiction, but for art altogether. In the creation of art, you escape the merely ideological you, the mere you who has opinions. The having of opinions is one of the most tedious things about us, as well as the most dangerous things about us. We get into trouble. We don't go to war over art, we go to war over opinions. And we are at our most dull. Who is the person that, you know, think of the people you know who bore you most. What bores you about them? Their opinions. Is there, if we were honest, is there anybody's opinions you really want to hear? Do you even want to hear your own opinions? Sometimes you just catch yourself at a dinner table. You've had a drink too. Could have happened to you last night in Frankfurt.
I fear it did.
At that moment, you start talking about what you believe. Yes. And you realise, what a crass person I am. What an absolutely commonplace, ordinary nobody I am when I express opinions. And art gives us the opportunity to get beyond our opinion. Not just to move, as a proper intellectual should, not just to move from an opinion to a judgment, because there is a big difference between an opinion and a judgment, but to move even beyond judgment into some world in which you're feeling your way through experience and either paint or musical notations or words create meaning. And they create a meaning, and then this is the great thing about art for anyone, but whether you make good art or you make bad art, you create feelings, you have thoughts, and you create feelings that you didn't know you had before. But art gives you the opportunity to have to have an internal life that you didn't have before when you had. Outside of art, we are just a bundle of mere opinions. Inside of art, and this is why he is the artist par excellence, because he is the artist with no opinions. Who is he? Who on earth was he?
I like my version of it as what Charles Bukowski, a rather disreputable, chaotic, shambolic... Yes. Drunkard, yes. Womanizing, hopeless, chain-smoking, over-fecund, beat, in literary sense, beat poet, said, without literature, life is hell.
It's good.
Yeah. But I think there's a paradox, though, in what you said. There's a paradox, which is that about the opinions. You need the Burkes with the opinions, though, don't you? I mean, you need them in the novel. You need them to write the newspaper columns. That there's got to be something to be contrary against, something to be satirical, reactive.
That's like saying if other people weren't stupid, you wouldn't have the chance to be intelligent.
Well, Guy, yes, it is a little bit, I suppose. But Guy, in the chapter that you read to us, Guy is a person whose passions and views are antagonistic, aren't they? He rebels and resents, and in this kind of wonderfully energized way, his negative opinions. And he needs, and you wouldn't be able to write your newspaper columns if there weren't things to provoke you.
Well, that's true. Yes, I won't fight you over that. That's true. I have a horrible feeling. Have we been talking too much?
We're probably coming to the end. We should have ended with Charles Bukowski's Aperçu,
yes,
shouldn't
yes.
we?
Yes. Without literature, life is hell. Good evening. Thank you for coming.
Very good.
Very good. Nice. Very, very nice. Nice. Thank you very much, Neil. Really, always good. Really, always good to talk.